chat box. This is a collaboration. I can see we have India, Nameda, Ankita, India as well, Ochuko, Nigeria, Samantha from Uganda. So many participants from India, Gag, Narvit Kaur, professor from, didn't say where, Ridula Goswami, Dr. Gurvanit from India. All are welcome. Thank you for joining us for our one of the many sessions that we are doing. So, Dr. Stephen Kinuthia from Kenya, Mehta from India, all are welcome. Right. So this is joint Saudi Arabia. We have Dr. Mohammed Dafar, and also the Prof. Goswami from India. Welcome all. So this is a collaboration from. Oh, we have one from Japan. This is a collaboration between Kenya Association of Pediatric Dentistry and the Federation of Special Care Dentistry. We have been having a series on special needs care of special needs patients. We have covered epilepsy. Today we will cover patients with cerebral palsy. This is to be done by Dr. Omar, who is running this session, and we will also have Dr. Priya, who will take over the question and answer session, and thereafter give a vote of thanks. We're also on Facebook Live. I will not be able to read the people who are sharing their locations on Facebook Live, but all should be welcome. Dr. Kumar, sorry, who's running the session, has a CV. He is qualified and an instructor, an associate professor at the Department of Pedodontics and Preventive Dentistry at Maulana Azad Institute of Dental Sciences in New Delhi. He is also the vice president of National Medical Organization in Delhi and a founder secretary of South Asian Association of Pediatric Dentistry. He has a CV there that has a lot of other qualifications. Thank you, Dr. Bhatt from India. We also have a CV there that has his major qualifications. Of course, this can go on and on, but he's here today because he understands best and will help us understand better the care of patients with cerebral.
Dr. Priya? Hello?
Yes, you're audible.
You are audible, but Dr. Elvis is not audible. Are you able to hear him?
No, no, no.
No, some internet problem is there.
Dr. Nick, can you hear us?
Yeah, I can hear you. I think Dr. Elvis, he's logged off a little bit.
Yeah. Okay, should I start, Dr. Priya?
Yes, please. Over to
yes,
you.
Dr. Kamar, you can start.
Okay. Thank you, Dr. Elvis, for a wonderful introduction. And first of all, I would like to thank Kenya Association of Pediatric Dentistry and Federation of Special Care Dentistry for giving me opportunity to speak about one of the most discussed and common special health condition in pediatric patients, that is a cerebral palsy. Okay. So this is my city where I live, Delhi. Hope you all been knowing of it. Delhi is a capital city of India and it is a second largest city of India. First is Mumbai, where is a Bollywood located, and that is a commercial hub, Mumbai. This is my workplace, my institute, where I have been working since as an associate professor since 16 years. It's my proud privilege to work as a secretary of South Asian Association of Pediatric Dentistry. The South Asian Association of Pediatric Dentistry consists of 6 countries: India, Nepal, Bhutan, Bangladesh, Maldives, and Sri Lanka. Before I proceed for the lecture, I want to show some video of one of the non-governmental organization who is actually working for the cerebral palsy patient. And the South Asian Association of Pediatric Dentistry has adopted this NGO for the dental management of the cerebral palsy cases. So just enjoy this video, please. I think video is not able to start. Dr. Priya, are you there?
Yes, I'm there.
Video is not able to start, I think. So I can.
Dr. Gyanendra, can you please check with the video sound?
There is no sound?
Very little. Please increase.
Okay. 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 First, we should understand what is a special health care needs. According to American Association of Pediatric Dentistry, a special health care needs is any physical, developmental, mental, sensory, behavioral, cognitive, emotional impairment, limiting condition that requires medical management, healthcare intervention, or use of a specialized service or programs. One such vulnerable condition in a special health care need is a cerebral palsy. Cerebral palsy is a neurological disorder occurring in approximately 2 to 2.5% out of 1,000 live births. Cerebral palsy describes a group of disorder in the development of movement and posture, which causes activity limitation that are accredited to non-progressive disturbances that occurred in the developing fetal and infant's brain. Okay. These factors for the development of cerebral palsy is elaborated beautifully by Sehrawat et al. One of their article. All the readers can go through this. They have divided all the risk factors into perinatal, that is related to mother during her gestation period, prenatal and perinatal are related to time of birth, like birth injuries, hypoxia, jaundice, and postnatal are related to child health condition after birth. The etiology of the cerebral palsy is perinatal, may be unknown cause, alcohol and other drugs, infections and illness of mother while she is pregnant, recess incompatibility, attempted abortion, pregnancy at any advanced age. Under the perinatal, etiology may be unknown cause, lack of oxygen, birth injuries, baby born too early, jaundice, and postnatal etiology may be very high fever, brain infections, head injuries, lack of oxygen, and poisoning. Discussing the classification of cerebral palsy, varying degree of involvement of body has led to various classification. One such classification is based on motor impairment. It includes the term spastic, dyskinetic, ataxia, hypotonic, and mixed. Based on a topographical distribution, the most commonly used terms are hemiplegia, diplegia, and quadriplegia. But the terms monoplegia, paraplegia, triplegia, double hemiplegia, and tetraplegia are also used. Another classification system is a gross motor classification system. It includes various levels such as level 1, that is given to the patient who walks without limitations. Level 2, children's walks with limitations. Level 3, children's walk using a handheld mobility devices. And level 4, using powered mobility device. Level 5, patients are transported in a manual wheelchairs. Not going into much detail of classification, just want to highlight that there are many more ways of classifying cerebral palsy according to the various body. The World Health Organization first given an international classification of functioning, it is endorsed by World Health Assembly in May 2019. International classification of functioning conceptualize a person's level of functioning as a dynamic interaction between his or her health condition, environmental factors, and personal factors. It describes disability as a dysfunction at one or more of these levels. First is impairment of body structure or functions. Second one is a limitations in activity. Third is restrictions of participation. One such way is diving patients according to their functional mobility scales. The rating 1 is a usage wheelchair, rating 2 usage walker or frame, rating 3 usage crutches, rating 4 usage sticks or canes, rating 5 is independent on level surfaces, and rating 6 is independent for all surfaces. Before discussing the management of cerebral palsy, we should aware of the dental manifestation of cerebral palsy. The most common manifestation of the dental manifestation is malocclusion. The prevalence rate of malocclusion has been reported between 59% and 92% in cerebral palsy patients. Uncoordinated movement of the jaws, lip and tongue, hypotonia of the orofacial muscles, mouth open posture with a postural tongue thrust and mouth breathing habit, majority of malocclusion are classified as a Engel's class 2. Article by Miyamoto et al. Had published in 2010 in one of the most esteemed journal of orthodontic discussed regarding the severity of malocclusion in a patient diagnosed with the cerebral palsy. In this study, two groups were made. In first group, children diagnosed with the spastic cerebral palsy were allocated, and control group, healthy subjects with the dental malocclusion were allocated. Criteria for dental aesthetic index was used for diagnosis of malocclusion. It was found that in this study, there was a significant difference between both the groups on the basis of variables such as overjet, overbite, lip competency, swallowing. It was concluded that the risk factor associated with the malocclusion in cerebral palsy were lip incompetence and mouth breathing. There is another study, association of occlusion with eating efficiency in children with the cerebral palsy and moderate in eating impairment. This study conducted by Schwartz et al., in which association of occlusion with the eating efficiency in children with the cerebral palsy was studied. It was found that there was a possible association between chewing efficiency and occlusal wear. It was found that occlusal problems affected the efficiency of ingestion of children with the cerebral palsy. Another dental manifestation is a traumatic dental injury, TDI. Children with the cerebral palsy have a high prevalence of class 2 malocclusion with a prominent maxillary central incisor, incompetent lips, increased incidence of seizures. All these factors predispose the child to the dental trauma. The risk of traumatic dental injuries varies between 10% to 20%, and it can reach up to 60%. Along the facial injury, these children are predisposed to fracture of enamel and dentine. The study done by Holland et al., they found that significantly increased incidence of dental trauma in cerebral palsy, that is around 57% of population. There is one study, Maria Teresa Botti et al. In this study, in a study conducted by Botti et al., it was found that TDI, traumatic dental injury prevalence in individual presenting with the cerebral palsy and attending rehabilitation treatment was similar compared with the non-disabled individuals, but they receive less treatment. Another oral manifestation is a bruxism. Bruxism is defined as habitual grinding of teeth. Bruxism is a common problem in children with the cerebral palsy, predominantly in those with the severe motor and cognitive deficits. Bruxism is likely to be a self-stimulatory behavior related to abnormal proprioception in the periodontium, leading to tooth abrasion and flattening of biting surfaces. There is a one study, Ortega et al. They have studied about the frequency of parafunctional oral habits in patients with the cerebral palsy. In this study, they have seen frequency of parafunctional habits in a patient with the cerebral palsy was assessed. It was found that 41.5% had tongue interposition, 36.9% had eccentric bruxism, 18.4% had a habit of biting objects, and 13.8% had a habit of pacifier sucking, and 6.1% had a habit of finger sucking. Children with the cerebral palsy are predisposed to such abnormal behaviors, which includes finger sucking and other habits. Sleeping disorder in children with the cerebral palsy may predispose to the development of bruxism, particularly in those with the severe visual impairment. The study conducted by Souza et al. Found that the involuntary movement, the male gender and gastroesophageal reflex are factors associated with the bruxism in the children with the developmental disabilities. Minier has hypothesized that bruxism habit in cerebral palsy patients are related to problem with the dopamine functions and not regulated to the local factors such as malocclusion. Another study, Sedki et al., and they found that the majority of children with the cerebral palsy have a dental caries, poor oral hygiene, and severe gingival inflammation. And also children with the level 4 gross motor functional classification system were prone to have a dental caries. Another oral manifestation is a periodontal disease. Periodontal disease is common in children with the cerebral palsy due to poor oral hygiene. Another factors include difficulty in conducting daily oral hygiene, intraoral sensitivity, orofacial motor dysfunctions, physical abilities, and malocclusions. The prevalence of periodontal disease is higher because of poor manual handiness of child of CP to perform a good oral hygiene measures and anticonvulsion medicaments induce gingival enlargement. That is a phenytoin. Most common oral manifestation is a dental caries. Children with a more severe neurological insult and cognitive and motor deficits are at a greater risk of developing dental caries. Ferreira, T. Camiroga et al. Found that the incidence of caries among children and adolescents with the cerebral palsy is high. But Quintela and Alfredo concluded that individuals with the cerebral palsy have less chance of having caries than the individuals in the comparison groups. Another study conducted by Botti et al. Oral condition in children with the cerebral palsy. They have concluded earlier prevalence measures of cerebral palsy patients are required because they are high risk of group of dental caries. Another study conducted by Pop et al. About the dental status of cerebral palsy children. Another manifestation is a dental erosion. Dental erosion is a common in patients with the palsy who are predisposed to gastroesophageal reflex disease. Studies found that 37% of cerebral palsy patients with the dental erosion had a history of gastroesophageal reflex disease. Another study says that swallowing difficulties and recurrent chest infection were associated with the development of dental erosion. The first indication of gastroesophageal reflex disease may be the enamel erosion that affects the posterior dentition. Most of the affected teeth observed in the cerebral palsy cases were upper molars, that is 54%, followed by lower molar and upper incisors. Another study, Abento et al. Concluded that the dental erosion in cerebral palsy children is associated with recurrent consumption of soft drinks and powdered juices. Coming to the dental management of children with the cerebral palsy. During the dental examination, treatment of children with the cerebral palsy, the following points should be considered. First one is some practical challenges are commonly encountered, which include apprehension, fear from strangers, low intelligence, poor concentration, and communication difficulties between cerebral palsy cases with the dentist when handling with the children with the cerebral palsy. If the child can sit in the chair and open his or her mouth, he or she can be treated as a normal patient. Those children with the less physical control need further helps. The dental chair must be adjusted carefully. The dental chair must be adjusted carefully, and most of these patients are best treated with the chair tipped well back to give a position of security. The specific type of patient having fairly severe head and neck involvement will require even more control and support, and can be seated on the knee of the patient, parents or an assistant, leaning back against the right shoulder. If the patient is using wheelchair, he or she should be considered to be treated in the wheelchair itself. The dentist may not establish much during the first visit. That may be used mainly to establish mutual confidence and have a preliminary assessment. Schedule should be early in the day, and also to allow sufficient time to establish appropriate interaction during the such encounters. Occasionally, assistance from the parents and dental assistants and the use of immobilization devices may be necessary to obtain a radiographs. The presence of supportive and relaxed approach can be helped in improving the child's cooperation. Head position of the patient with the cerebral palsy can be maintained in the midline of the by the help of Velcro straps, and open mouth can be obtained and maintained with the use of mouth props. A dentist should try to be gentle and caring, and he should avoid sudden movement which may trigger muscles stiffening and spasm. A finger guard and use a steel mirror are also preferred to avoid injuries. Sharp instrument when used should be used with the extreme caution so as to prevent injuries. Canvas straps equipped with the Velcro fasteners can be used to restrain the arms and legs which encircle the limbs and arms and foot portion of the dental chair. To protect the skin of the patient, towel can be placed over the arms or leg to avoid the injuries or any force. Another effective method of immobilization is wrapping sheet around the patients. Preventive approach should be a team effort, involving mutual efforts between dentist, hygienist, assistant, patients, family, and other persons who are having impact of patient's life. Since the pediatric dentistry imposes a greater role in management of children with the cerebral palsy, knowing the role of periodontist is essential. For treatment of malocclusal, orthodontic treatment may not be treatment option in children with the cerebral palsy because of the risk of caries and enamel hypoplasia. When considering orthodontic treatment in children with the disabilities, the following basic requirements need to be satisfied, which include the commitment of both patient and parents, along with the adequate oral hygiene and the degree of patient's cooperation. In recent years, certain technological improvements are done in dentistry, which could benefit disabled dental patients in general, including cerebral palsy patients who are receiving orthodontic treatment. They include impression using quick set materials, use of self-etching primers, self-ligating brackets, and use of reversible mini implant anchorages. Orthodontic treatment is feasible in cerebral palsy children after a careful patient selection. Success depends on factors such as type and severity of malocclusion and the degree of patient's cooperation. Come to the traumatic dental injury. Traumatic dental injury, this factor associated with the traumatic dental injuries includes falls, collisions, seizures, tooth grinding, accentuated overjet, and lack of lip seals. In cerebral palsy patients, there is an uncontrollable movement of the head which increase the risk of dental trauma since the teeth may strike against the hard objects. Thus, lip seals act as a protective factors. A periodontist should educate the parents, teacher, and caregivers in a correct emergency care of cerebral palsy patients after traumatic injury to search for preventive measures such as the use of mouth guards during the playing a game and all, the padding of objects and hard surfaces and safe transport of teeth. Also emphasize to caregivers that trauma requires immediate specialized attention and explain the procedure to follow. If a permanent tooth is knocked out, suggest a tooth storage media. Also instruct caregiver to find any missing pieces of a fractured teeth. Another oral manifestation is a bruxism. Bruxism treatment options include restorative treatments, occlusal alteration, use of oral splints, dental extraction, and pharmacological treatments. The most severe cases require a multidisciplinary approach, including pediatricians, psychiatrists, pediatric dentist, and oral surgeon. Sleep disorder may also predispose to the development of nocturnal bruxism, predominantly in those with a severe visual impairment. Gagging or swallowing problem must be considered in cerebral palsy patients before recommending mouth guards. About bite splints as it may make them uncomfortable or unwearable. Dental features such as hypotonia and open bite contribute to drooling of saliva, which affects daily oral care. For management of periodontal diseases, important factor associated with the periodontal disease is the use of anti-epileptic drugs, particularly phenytoin. Gingival hyperplasia is predictive for the periodontal diseases. The periodontist should talk to caregiver about daily oral hygiene and demonstrate proper brushing and flossing technique to them and emphasize them on regular approach to oral hygiene. Daily use of antimicrobial agents such as chlorhexidine may be beneficial. Chlorhexidine applied using a spray bottle or toothbrush is equally efficacious, as rinsing may not work for a patient with the swallowing difficulty. So be cautious for that. Only chlorhexidine apply with the spray bottle and toothbrush or on the toothbrush. For the dental care, management of the dental caries, the periodontist should advise caregivers to make a patient to drink water often, take sugar-free medicines when available, and rinse with water after taking any medicine. Also to give alternatives to cariogenic foods and beverages. Recommend them for preventive measures such as fluorides and pit and fissure sealants. For dental erosion, firstly, dentists should be able to diagnose early sign of dental erosion in cerebral palsy patient and provide appropriate preventive therapy and also referral for the diagnosis and treatment of gastroesophageal reflux disease. And so avoid irreversible damage to the dentition. The home dental care for cerebral palsy patient is mandatory. All the periodontists should know about the home dental care for the cerebral palsy patients. It is essential to begin home dental care for the children with the cerebral palsy in infancy. The dentist should teach them parents and caregivers to gently cleanse and the incisors daily with the soft cloth and infant's toothbrush. For children who are physically unable to cooperate, the dentist should teach the parents or caregivers for the correct toothbrushing technique to avoid the dental caries. For children with a disability, electric toothbrush have also been used effectively. Parents should always help the child to brush his or her teeth, and the head of the child must always be supported. Almost all the medications which are prescribed to the children contain sucrose for the cerebral palsy. Thus, a child on a oral medication must get their teeth cleansed after each medication. Sedation and general anesthesia are also proven effective for the managing children with the cerebral palsy. Children with the cerebral palsy may be uncooperative and difficult to handle and during dental treatment. So sedation and anesthesia are frequently needed in a such situation. It is essential to obtain an accurate medical history and dental history. An evaluation of pre-existing medical condition must be performed before any therapeutic measures. History of respiratory difficulties and seizure represents a meticulous challenges. Assessment by the concerned specialty, which include pediatrics, pediatricians, anesthesia, neurology, is often needed prior to the any procedure. Many drugs can be used to induce sedation and anesthesia, including benzodiazepine, nitrous oxide, narcotics, propofol, and adjunct drugs such as anticyanogogs. In milder cases, nasal or face mask can be utilized to avoid the fear and anxiety which is associated with the IV sedation, IV insertion or sedation. Those who have moderate range of disability will let you place nasal mask if it is shown to them and if it is function is and if its function is explained. Oxygen saturation should be monitored by pulse oximetry, and the airway should be protected throughout the procedure, decreasing the likelihood of the hypoxia. A throat shield should always be used in children with the cerebral palsy to protect the airways, as there is an increased risk of aspiration, dental filling materials, debris while preparation of the tooth, even extracted teeth. The precautions should be always taken. Post-operative care includes keeping the child with the physical restraint until he or she is able to respond to verbal commands and become fully conscious. Instructions to the parents will be given prior to the appointment in written form with the scheduled appointment with 24 hours contact number of the practitioner, no milk or solid food 6 hours before the appointment. Clear liquid such as water, clear juices, gelatin, broth may be given up to 3 hours before the appointment to prevent the gagging reflex. The plan the child's sleep and awakening times to encourage the usual amount of sleep the day before the sedation appointment. Ask the patient to arrive on time for your scheduled appointment. This is a long appointment. That is the second one. First one is the interaction between the cerebral palsy patient and dentist should be very small. Only make a report between the cerebral palsy patients and the dentist. But the for the sedation period, ask them arrive on time for your scheduled appointment. This is long appointment and you may be here for several hours. The legal guardian or caregiver must accompany the child to the sedation appointment. A second responsible adult must join them and your child at the time of discharge. Make sure a child uses the restroom before the sedation procedures. The requirements of the sedation, the personal requirements are dentist, dental operator, and an assistant trained in a life supporting methods. Restraining agents, papoose board, and pedi wraps. Devices like precordial stethoscope and pulse oximeter should be there. Pre-procedural prescriptions should be given. Minor tranquilizers like diazepam can be given as a pre-medication. Pre-medication. Chlorhydrate and mepridine are not considered minor tranquilizers and should not be administered outside dental office. So make sure you will not use chlorhydrate and meperidine. Use only digipharm can be given before the coming for the sedation period. Intravenous cannulas and monitors should be detached as soon as possible as they increase the child's fear and anxiety. There is a one study, Rodriguez et al. In his paper investigated various treatment modalities for performing dental procedure in children with the cerebral palsy from general anesthesia to conventional technique. And sample taken in two groups, one is children, another is adolescent and younger adults. And he concluded that GA with the general anesthesia with the sevoflurane, propofol and conscious sedations are excellent tools to provide a dental treatment in these patients. And no such a major complications have seen in their study. The take-home message for today's lecture is the oral health of children with the special health care needs has always been found a poor when compared to otherwise healthy children's. Oral health is increasingly recognized as a foundation for general health, wellness, and a primary indicator for the success of dental treatment. The caregivers for special needs patients must become knowledgeable and competent in home oral health practices. The role of the pediatric dentist is to improve oral care health wellness and to encourage parents and caregivers for good home and oral health practice. I'm sure you have learned a lot about the cerebral palsy. How can you prevent the oral manifestation of cerebral palsy cases and how to treat? What the precautions you will take in the, your clinic? Thank you very much. Dr. Priya, over to you. Hello.
Thank you, Dr. Gyanendra. Thank you very much for that well-delegated webinar with a lot of literature put into the presentation. Thank you very much. We can now go ahead with question and answers. And I think you have pretty much cleared everything to everyone. We do not have much questions here.
It's a very basic presentation for cerebral palsy, and each and every pediatric dentist should know how to treat a patient with a cerebral palsy. Yes. And what is the your clinic position, and what is the chair position, what precautions, what armamentarium you should use. And there are various study has already, taken up for the all the cases.
Thank you very much. That was pretty well explained. I must say I'm still waiting for some queries.
Well in time. Okay, no problem.
Very well in time. Dr. Elvis, would you like to take it over from here? Because we don't seem to have much queries, and this was a very self-explanatory seminar. So, okay, well, we have something. We have a query from anonymous attendee asking if you would like to comment on the use of rubber dam.
Yeah, you can use, but you should aware of that ki patient is very, very apprehensive and very, the extra skills should be needed for the dentist. For the drooling of saliva is much of the cerebral palsy, so you can use rubber dam with the precautions. But there is chances of ingestion of the clamps and all. So you should use with the very skilled manner.
In a very skilled manner. We have another query from Samantha Kachwinya that the doctor would like more clarity on the pharmacological management of bruxism.
This is another question. In cerebral palsy cases, already they have treated with the pediatricians and the physicians, whatever. They have well treated by the them. And the pharmacological drugs, which is given for the bruxism, only they can take up. We can't prescribe as for the norms. So Dr. Samantha, just you will refer to the patient with the pediatrician or the physician who is their actually treated patient. We are dealing with the only dental management.
I would like to add something over here.
Dr. Amina is asking about the conscious sedation is performed in cerebral palsy. Yes, of course, we have already discussed about this. Many of the studies told that the general anesthesia and conscious sedation is excellent for the dental treatment with the cerebral palsy. I have quoted two or three studies over that for the general anesthesia and conscious sedation. So refer to that only, Dr. Amina ma'am.
Okay, we have another question from Mihir Nayak. Dr. Mihir Nayak, what is your opinion on Castellino Morales appliance usage, please?
I'm not aware of it, Dr. Priya. I'll read it out and explain to him. Dr. Mihir, I'll come back to you after the reading.
There is another question from an anonymous attendee that what kind of treatment should be done at the first visit of cerebral palsy children as they come sometimes with so many caries, oromotor problems and drooling saliva?
As I have already told that the first visit should be very short and sweet and make a rapport between the cerebral palsy patients and the dentist. Make them comfortable with you. Once patient is comfortable, then you will treat for the dental caries and all under the general anesthesia and a conscious sedation, whatever is convenient for you. So first visit should be very short and sweet.
As a general rule, along with keeping the visit short, I think we should all we can just add that any emergency complaint, if there is any emergency complaint that patient is walking in with, if it's not a routine checkup and if it's an emergency procedure that has to be done, that should be looked at. Besides that, I don't think that we should go for any treatment during the first visit.
Yeah, very well said.
There's another question from Dr. Brenda Muhammad. If the patient is sedated, is the use of rubber dam necessary?
Please. Go ahead, Dr.
Brenda Muhammad is asking, if the patient is sedated, is the use of rubber dam necessary?
What kind of sedation they have given? If there is general anesthesia, there is suction is there in general anesthesia. So there is no need to use a rubber clamp, but in conscious sedation you can use with the skilled manner and prevent the clamp with the some hooks and all. There is a one rubber band and something, so it cannot slip into the pharynx.
Another question from Brenda Muhammad: what is the place of music therapy in managing these patients?
There are a lot of study about music and the cerebral palsy. No doubt, it's very effective and they are receiving it very well. The music therapy is good for the cerebral palsy. As we have NGO Dr. Priya, we have treating a dental problems with the cerebral palsy. We use music. Okay, we dance with them. We sing a song, and surrounding with the music, so it give a soothing environment.
Yeah, I think except autism, music therapy works well in most of the cases.
Special healthcare needs. Yes, you are right.
Autism, I'll give autism a skip on that. Besides that, I think music therapy works well not only for special care, for normal patients, everyone. I think it's a very relaxing modality for most of the patients. So there's another question from Dr. Amina. Usually such patients are on some medication. What precautionary measures should be followed if doing sedation? Dr. Amina says that usually these patients are on some sort of medication. like if there is any comorbidity, they would be on anti-epileptic, they would be on some antipsychotics or something. Yeah. What are the precautionary measures we should follow if we are doing sedation?
There are various literatures is available, Dr. Meena Ma'am, who is stated that the treatment modalities are under the general anesthesia and conscious sedation. So I'll send you all the related article to you, Dr. Meena Ma'am. You will be able to understand what medication they are taking and what type of precautions you can take.
Yeah, I think if we go with the basic knowledge, Dr. Meena, I think the first and the foremost, we should, if it's anything pertaining to medicine, the child should go back to the treating physician. I personally think that treating an advice or a note from a treating physician is very, very elementary and essential before we go on into any sort of modification of their medication. Another question is, as mentioned before, they can accept malocclusion correction treatment. What is the deciding factor in?
In a recent year, we are taking orthodontic treatment of the cerebral palsy cases. It depends on the only severity and class of the malocclusion and acceptability of the patients too. It totally depends on the severity and the class of the malocclusion and acceptance of the patient.
The yes. functionality of the patient.
Yeah, of course.
Yeah, comes from Dr. Sridhar Mukteni. What is the dose of NIOS, that is nitrous oxide oxygen inhalation sedation, maximum in a cerebral palsy patient?
What is the dose of nitrous oxide?
I think that should be calibrated by the patient, by the doctor itself. It has to be decided by the sedation is that what is the maximum dose of the NIOS that can be given looking at their symptoms?
Yes.
Another question we have, is it possible to get a lecture or handouts in addition to the recorded lecture? I think the KAPD organizers would be able to answer that better. We'll move on to the next question. What about distraction technique for pain and anxiety reduction in special child?
Behavior management itself very effective for the cerebral palsy cases. So you can use the distraction technique for the pain and anxiety if you want.
What is the preferable techniques for these children?
We will find out, Dr. Anuja, and let you know.
Okay, then we have some more questions over here. There's a question from Dr. Babita. Is there a need of anesthetist while using conscious sedation in cerebral palsy patients?
Most of the country having their own rules and regulations regarding the conscious sedation, use of conscious sedation or nitrous oxide. If your country allowed to do freely, then you can do. But in country India, we are not able to use nitrous oxide without anesthetics. Okay, it totally depends on your country's guidelines.
Yes. So what level of CP can you safely use nitrous oxide sedation?
Exactly, I don't know, but I'll find out. Dr. Priya?
Yes.
There are various classification is there, but for the conscious sedation, we can't find any literature for that.
I do not think that the usage of nitrous oxide sedation would be pretty much dependent upon the level of cerebral palsy, as it is a non-progressive disorder. So once it has happened, it is a non-progressive disorder, and I really do not think so that the usage of nitrous oxide would be dependent upon the level of functionality.
Actually, Dr. Priya, the classification has given by the many authors, so we can't say exactly what type of level. Okay, there is a international functioning system is there. Motor based system is there. There is another classification which already discussed about. So we are not able to find out the literature which says that what type of level we can use the conscious sedation or nitrous oxide.
Most of the time, I think the question would be pertaining to the hemiplegia or the functionality level. So in that case, I think the level of nitrous oxide would not be too much of importance. Another question is that is answered, already answered. We would go to the next question. Okay, thank you, Dr. Ganinder. We are pretty much done with all the question and answers. And
Thank you, Dr. Pia.
Yeah, I'll hand it over to Dr. Elvis, and he can take it forward from here. Thank you very much.
All right, thank you, Dr. Pia. Thank you, Dr. Kamar, for the wonderful presentation and the question and answers that have arisen and have been well answered. For those of you who are asking about the handouts, every presentation, the speaker tends to leave their email contacts, like Dr. Kumar has just done. So kindly reach out to them for that is their content. If they're happy to share with you, they will definitely send it to your email. Most of these emails are personal, so you can reach the presenters directly. The next round of presentations will be happening in November, and this will be on cleft lip and palate. Please join the KAPD Association for those of you in Kenya. This is at a cost of 5,000 shillings for the doctors and 4,000 shillings for the undergraduate students. We would like to thank you very much, Dr. Kamar. This was a wonderful presentation.
Thank you. Thank you.
We have had a wonderful idea and reminder in terms of how the management of cerebral palsy patients should be undertaken to even the level of orthodontic treatment, which some people would be very wary about. We, of course, would like to engage with you more, and we will do this in future. And we would like to thank all those who have attended today. And we will keep sharing whenever the, Dr. Kamara is able to present with us further, because this is a field that he is very passionate about. So for all of you who attended, thank you. We will send the points, the CPD points will be sent directly to your diaries, online diaries, for those in Kenya. For those outside the country, we believe that you've had a good session in this kind of presentation. Yes, Dr. Kamar.
Thank you. Thank you very much, Dr. Elvis, for giving me opportunity for on this digital platform. And thank you, Kenya, for having us.
All right, you're welcome, and please visit when Corona subsides.
Of course, I love to visit Kenya very soon.
You're more than welcome. Same to you, Dr. Priya, and all of you from all over the world. Kindly feel welcome to tour this part of the country to see your safari in this area. Thank you, and have a good night.
Thank you, and good night too.
Good night. Goodbye.